question I was asked was about UPSC. The chairman sir tried to put me under pressure. It's like a stress interview. For every answer, he counted me with his own argument. I sensed that they are deliberately trying to put me in a corner. So I tried to maintain my temper as much as possible. And
Hi everyone, my name is Anuchindal. Welcome to my channel. Today I have a very special guest, Ravi Chandra Virela, who has cleared RBI Grade B examination in the year 2021. Very recently, the results just came out. And first of all, congratulations to you, Ravi Chandra, on clearing the examination.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
And before we start with the actual interview with the questions and answers, I would want you can probably talk a little bit about yourself, about your education, work experience, your past failures. That is very important before this great success, so that the students have a generic idea about it, and then we'll move forward.
Oh, fine, sir. I am Ravi Chandra. I am from the state of Andhra Pradesh, where most of my education happened. I graduated in Electronics and Communication Engineering in 2014. Thereafter, I worked for 3 years in TCS as systems engineer. And then I decided to pursue my aspiration of being a civil servant. So I resigned my job and went for coaching. And I have given 3 attempts, of which I was able to qualify the prelims 2 times, but could not make it. And then when I was exploring the other options, I came to know about RBI Grade B in the process. So I gave my first attempt in 2018 for RBI Grade B. Due to lack of preparation, I could not make it. And 2021 was my second attempt in RBI. Sir, I could not hear you.
Yes, amazing. So let's move forward. Since you are a UPSC aspirant, you have been a UPSC aspirant, so a lot of students will think that it is only because of UPSC that you got through. That is the preconception, but I know that is not true. There's a lot of hard work separately for RBI, which also goes into play. So let us start with phase one and try and understand the sources that you used and the strategy that you created, how you covered general awareness. How was it different from UPSC prep? How did you move forward with your entire preparation?
Yes, sir. As you have rightly mentioned, I agree that it is a big misconception, because the general awareness portion, especially when we talk about the phase one, the kind of questions we get in UPSC prelims is entirely different. So, and the reasoning, logical reasoning and aptitude also, the civil services aspirants feel it very difficult. As far as GA is considered, I have gone through few of the magazines like Bankers Adda and FI's Cloud for GA portion. I revised them multiple times and I attempted as many mocks as possible for the GA portion. And for the logical reasoning, I identified that is my weak area initially through mock tests. So I took help of some friends who are already preparing for various exams like CAT and CGL. So with their help, I was able to learn few tricks and applied them for solving logical reasoning. And quant, I'm quite comfortable from my graduation days. So I was able to attempt a good number of questions.
Coming back to general awareness, you mentioned that you use certain sources.
Yes, sir.
Last year, we saw that the paper was very difficult compared to the previous attempts, the previous papers. And we had a lot of phase two kind of questions or UPSC kind of questions also asked in the phase one general awareness. Okay. More analytically,
yes,
more
sir.
Detailed
yes, questions. Like multiple statement questions.
Yes, yes. The pattern changed a little. And because of that, a lot of students panicked. A lot of students
yes.
could not clear the examination even after a lot of studies. Okay, so subconsciously or consciously, I'm very, very certain that this must have happened, that you were already prepared with phase two kind of current affairs before your phase one examination, right? So, did you specifically prepare for phase two current affairs before phase one, or was it your UPSC preparation of current affairs that helped you?
No, sir, there is no separate preparation for phase one and two. I would say my preparation is integrative, like for both phases, and the accumulated knowledge that I got in these 3 4 years of preparation that certainly has played a key role in my success in the examination. And regarding phase two, the descriptive pattern that is newly introduced, I can say that the writing experience that I have helped me. Although typing is a different job, but I can say that having the structured answer in the mind, it definitely gave me a confidence
Yes,
in the phase two.
that must have helped. So the conclusion here is, if I'm incorrect, please correct me, that before going in for phase one examination, if a student is specifically and only focused on RBI preparation, let's say, and he's going for phase one examination tomorrow, then he has to make sure that he's prepared for phase one and phase two current affairs simultaneously in advance only. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. I totally agree with that. Yeah, because
Perfect.
we cannot say for sure like this. We cannot demarcate clearly that this is phase one and this is phase two. And
Yes.
with growing competition, the kind of questions they are asking, we have to prepare both the phases simultaneously.
Yes. The reason that I asked this question specifically is because a lot of students make this mistake even after repeating it again and again. So when they hear it from your mouth, from a student who's got selected, then they take it more seriously. Okay, he's saying it, so now I think it must be correct. That's the entire idea of asking this question.
Okay,
Let's
fine.
move to phase two now. Phase two may, yes, I'm certain UPSC prep must have been a big help.
Yes, sir.
What about finance and management? You don't have that kind of background. So how did you prepare for that?
Yeah, for finance portion, the kind of conceptual knowledge I have from the civil services experience that help, like, but beyond that, some other like ratios, solving numericals. These things I relied upon your videos for finance portion, and then few of the other institutes they are providing short notes like, and for that portion finance and management also I relied on those handbooks.
Those must have helped. Yes, yes,
Yeah.
yes. Let's come to the descriptive part now. Of course, ESI descriptive part, I don't think there is any need to discuss that because UPSC is the one that helped you in that as well. When we talk about finance and management descriptive part, the way the question is framed and the kind of answer that they're looking for is certainly, certainly requires some kind of in-depth understanding or knowledge, right?
Yes, sir.
And because the length of the answer is also very long, 400 words, 500 words, you certainly need to write a lot. So how did you
Yes.
tackle that in that limited time span?
Sir, one thing is like choosing the question that we want to answer. Like in the given, 3 questions are given and we have to write two. So I chose those questions wherein we can write different subheads. Like in the finance part, they have given about different institutions, SIDBI, NHB. So we can easily write a couple of points about each organization and that can give us the length. So having different subheads and under each subhead, 3 4 bullet points that can justify the answer. In that way, structuring the answer in the mind before starting typing, that really helps. And giving relevant current affairs examples also, especially in the management part where they asked about the importance of corporate management. So quoting live examples from the current affairs that helped me. That's what I feel.
Certainly, certainly. Ravi, I want to ask you one question, which I think I've not asked anyone else till now, all the aspirants who've cleared, but I think you would be the right person to answer that. When we are attempting question on a laptop or on a desktop, then, or even if you are attempting it offline on pen and paper, what the problem that a lot of us amongst us face is how to structure it before writing it. Okay, so a lot of students, what they do is they they normally make a rough structure before writing it down, before writing the actual. So what they'll do is they'll write out the rough points. Okay, these are the subheads or subpoints that I'm going to write. What was the procedure that you followed when answering a question? Did you just start answering the question instantly after reading it and, you know, deciding, okay, this is what I'm going to write? Or did you have it in mind that I'm going to spend 5 minutes on structuring it, on identifying all the key points, and then I'll write it?
Sir, actually, in ESI and FM, we don't have sufficient time because we have to type 2000 words in 90 minutes. Whereas in case of English, we have the luxury. So we can pen down and structure the answer. So for ESI and FM, I have read the question and framed the structure in mind. Just I thought for 1 to 2 minutes, like my intro should be like this. So that in the intro itself, the examiner must get the picture that this guy understood the question, demand of the question. So I directly shot the bullseye in the introduction, bullseye. And then when come to body, I have 3-4 subheads. So, and each subhead, 3-4 points, bullet points, including government schemes or data or examples, whatever I have prepared and whatever I could recollect at that point of time. So in these 2 minutes, I framed the structure and the conclusion also, what can be the better way and in a positive way, like we are told in the answer writing, the conclusion should be in an optimistic note. So for 2 minutes, I thought of the structure and then I jumped into typing the answer, sir.
So the conclusion that we can gather here is that we have to structure the answers, if not on paper, then at least in our mind before actually writing it. Because I have come across a lot of students who make this mistake. They go by their intuition. Okay, this is something that I feel I can write. Let me start writing. And then they realize down the line that they don't have enough points. So I think this is something that we need to learn. Because let's be honest with ourselves, a lot of aspirants are not UPSC aspirants. So they have forgotten how to write, or at least they've forgotten how to write answers. So, you know, getting used to it either through practice or through something like you did, I think it's going to be very helpful. Okay. Let me come to something called as reverse engineering, which I'm sure you must have used a lot, which is usage of questions in order to answer, in order to learn more and more and, you know, yes, practice sir, as much as possible. How many mocks or how many questions, or did you rely a lot or to a considerable extent on using questions to learn new topics or using questions to, you know, go in the right direction while preparing?
Sir, this reverse engineering I applied mostly for management section, because I just have one subject, engineering called MEPA, but after that I completely forgot. So I picked up the important areas where like there is a possibility for both subject descriptive as well as objective questions, like the theories, who are their proponents, what are the components in each theory. So while solving the MCQs, through MCQs, I use it to make notes like mnemonics or mind maps, shortcuts for remembering the theories. And the second part where I use this technique is even after reading multiple sources, it is important to recollect the answer at that point in time. So I attempted more number of mocks and make notes for GA where like in areas where I'm weak or I feel that I can forget this. So I made a short note and just before the exam, I used to refer those.
I think that's a very useful technique, and I'm very glad that you used it a lot before your examination. In management, I think through case studies, it is very, very successful. You must have used that. Okay, let's now come to the interview part, because I see that there is a significant amount of gap, if not very long, even then there is some gap. So how did the interview go? Did they ask you about UPSC and how did you tackle that problem? Because you don't have any background specifically in this area.
The chairman, sir, initially started with UPSC only. The first question I was asked was about UPSC. The chairman, sir, tried to put me under pressure. It's like a stress interview. For every answer, he countered me with his own argument. I sensed that they are deliberately trying to put me in a corner. So I tried to maintain my temper as much as possible, and like they were like, if you want to work for public welfare, then why don't you join SBI? Why RBI? They are like that. So when I gave the answer, like through RBI I can contribute to policy making, then chairmen are asked what define policy making. So apart from chairman sir, other members were very cordial. They asked me about the UPSC, how many attempts you gave, what is your optional, what happened. And then most of the questions are based on my bio data. So my father is a farmer, so they asked me about the agricultural formulas and its impact in Andhra Pradesh. What is the mood of the farmers there? Mm. And what are the problems the farmers facing in your state?
Mm.
What are the areas where your state is ahead and other states can take a cue from your state, in especially in agriculture?
Mm.
And then few basic questions about RBI website and how you have prepared for this interview. What are the sources you have referred? Mm. And there is no much grilling in the technical aspect, only about the biodata and the HR part.
Mm.
They focused.
Mm-hmm. So every interview is unique. The last interview discussion I was having with another successful aspirant, his interview was completely surprising because he had a lot to offer in his biodata form, but they did not ask any question from there. So they just want to surprise you and see how you react. So probably yours was supposed to be a stress interview, but I'm glad that you, came alive out of that unhurt, because I have met a lot of aspirants who get emotional in that stress kind of an environment, and then they realize that they've made a big mistake. That is what the interview panel was looking for. Okay, so before we finish off with the interview, I would request ki if you have anything that you want to share with the future aspirants, anything that you learned from this success or from your past failures, anything that you want to share, you're most welcome. You should do that now.
Yes, sir. My best session would be like, believe in yourself, like you can do it. Although their failures are common, I mean everyone faces failure. Getting up after falling on the ground is the most important thing.
Right. So
don't panic if you face a failure.
Hmm.
Begin, believe in yourself, begin and become what you want to become. That's it I want to say. And especially for RBI grade B, if you are a fresher, if you are starting on a clean slate, then please plan your preparation at least 6 months ahead of the notification, so that it will be easy for you to sail through the examination in the first attempt if you are aiming for that. And other aspirants, like UPSC aspirants who are planning for RBI, I would say that work on the areas, especially in the logical reasoning part and GA part, that really helps. And practice as many mock tests as possible, so that we get accustomed to the pattern and the time pressure that RBI has. And all the best.
Thanks a lot. I think what you have mentioned about failures and success, I think it's very, very important. The problem is that when we were young, when we were kids, then, we were not concerned about our failures. We would, keep failing. I used to fail a lot when I was in school, but I was never concerned about it. I never worried about it. My parents did. I never did. But everything worked out well. So I think even if you fail now, it should not affect you that much. Life is beautiful and we should enjoy it. I think that's the most important message. And you have...
I would say that comparing with our peers is a thief of joy. I would say don't compare yourself. Every one of us is a unique human being. We have our own strengths and weaknesses.
Amazing. Thanks a lot, Ravi, for coming here and sharing your views, for talking with us. And I think it was beautiful talking to you. I felt very, very nice. I think one thing that I can take from you is the humbleness that you bring to the table. And I'm very, very certain that the panel also must have seen the same. And that, see, these kind of personality traits really attract, people to have you in their company. And this is not something that can be faked. So I think that is something that all the aspirants can also take a cue from, as you said, from you, to stay humble and not be too worried about life, to take failures as steps to success. Thanks a lot, Ravi, and all the best for your future endeavors. Take care.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, Team Anujindal.